and turn to Psalm 83. Psalm 83. Of course, if you have notes on your Bible, especially with the Psalms, it'll tell you at the beginning a song or psalm of Asaph. Verse 1, keep not thou silent, O God. Hold not thy peace, and be not still, O God. For lo, thine enemies make atonement. In other words, an uproar. And they that hate thee have lifted up the head. They have taken crafty counsel against thy people and consulted against thy hidden ones. They have said, come and let us cut them off from being a nation. Talking about the children of Israel. That the name of Israel may be no more in remembrance. For they have consulted together with one consent. They are confederate against thee. The tabernacles of Edom and the Ishmaelites, of Moab and the Harginians, Gebal and Ammon and Amalek, the Philistines, with the inhabitants of Tyre. Asher also is joined with them. They have hopened the children of Lot, Selah. Do unto them as unto the Midianites, as to Sisera, as to Jabin, at the brook of Kishon, which perished at Endor, they became as dung for the earth. Make their nobles like Oreb and like Zeba. Yea, all their princesses as Zeba and as Zalmunna, who said, let us take ourselves the houses of God in possession. O my God, make them like a wheel, as the stubble before the wind. As the fire burneth the wood, and as the flame setteth the mountains on fire. So persecute them with thy tempest, and make them afraid with thy storm. Fill their faces with shame, that they may seek thy name, O Lord. Let them be confounded and troubled forever. Yea, let them be put to shame and perish, that men may know that thou, whose name alone is Jehovah, art the Most High over all the earth. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for your goodness and mercy to us today. We pray, dear Lord, as we come to this, your message tonight, that you give me clarity of thought and mind as I preach. And dear Lord, set me aside and fill me full of your spirit. Give me unction and power from on high and the strength I need to preach tonight. I pray that each and every person would have their heart open unto your word, that we could be able to learn from this and grow from it. For it's in Christ's name we pray, and amen. Here, we see God talking about a specific event in their future. We see a list of names that are given of his enemies. God is dealing here concerning the second coming. And that's what we're going to look at tonight, the second coming in Psalms. You know, there's several Psalms that deal with this issue. And we see it in a great world, or great in the world that we live in. Flip with me back to Psalm chapter 2 for a minute. We'll look at something there and then come back to 83. You there? The Bible says in verse 1, why do the heathen rage and the people imagine a vain thing? The kings of the earth set themselves and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against His anointed, saying, let us break their bands asunder and cast away their cords from us. They, or he that sitteth in the heavens, shall laugh. The Lord shall have them in derision. Then shall he speak unto them in his wrath, and vex them in his sore displeasure. Yet have I set my king upon my holy hill of Zion. I will declare the decree. The Lord hath said unto me, thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee. Ask of me, and I shall give thee the heathen for thine inheritance, and the uttermost parts of the earth for thy possession. Thou shalt break them with a rod of iron. Thou shalt dash them in pieces like a potter's vessel. Be wise now, therefore, O ye kings. Be instructed, ye judges of the earth. Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling. Kiss the Son, lest he be angry and ye perish from the way when his wrath is kindled but a little. Blessed are they that put their trust in him. This also is a picture of the second coming of Christ. Think about this. In verse 1 of Psalm 2, he says, why do the heathen rage and people imagine a vain thing? You think about the world we live in today and what people are doing. They imagine a vain thing. Everybody worships the same God. That is a vain thing. Listen, a God that has no heaven or hell is not a God. There's no punishment. A God is there to instruct and lead and for us to follow, not just to pander. God is a God of judgment. You look out through all history, every people who has their, and I'm going to say it this way, little gods, thinks their gods bring wrath and fury as well as blessings, right? Check it. All through history, you see that. So why do we in these last days come down and all of a sudden we try to raise up a God that is not righteous, that is not just, and will not punish sinners for sin? But the people imagine a vain thing in the day that we live. They rise up against him. The heathen rage. Man, you look at the world and how it's raging. Now listen, I don't agree with Franklin Graham in a lot of areas. I hope he was right in this statement. But I don't know if he was. After the elections this week, he put out this statement. There's a big article on it in Yahoo about how he believed God put this progressive anti-God agenda to a halt this week.
Amen. Praise God.
A halt, a stop in everything that they're doing. Now, I don't know if he's right. Why do I say that? Because of what the Bible says about the end times. If he's right, listen, then we're not close to the rapture. Because if it stops, it's got to get a lot worse than what it is now. I truly believe that. But he has kind of the right thought in mind. This agenda that the world is going against God, this anti-God, anti-home, everything about it. Man, I hate to say that I rejoice in seeing it, But the reason I would rejoice and sing it is because it lets me know, hey, the rapture is about to happen, amen? He's about to come. Do I agree with it? No. I would like to go downtown and puke on that sidewalk thing they did.
Amen.
It makes me sick. But that's the world we live in today. It's going to get worse and worse. It's just a fulfillment. Why do the heathen rage? They're raging greater and greater in the day that we live. Listen, if I'm right, there'll be a time in the near future where I won't be able to preach like this because I'll be in jail. You won't be able to believe the Bible the way it's written because you'll be in jail. Well, you can still believe it, but you won't be able to do it freely and openly. You'll be in jail. Times are getting worse. The heathen are raging. But notice in verse 5 of Psalm 2, then shall he speak unto them in his wrath and vex them in his sore displeasure. Hold your place there. Turn to the last book. Chapter 19, verse 11, and I saw the heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness doth he judge and make war. His eyes were a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns, and he had a name written that no man knew but himself. And he was clothed in a vesture dipped in blood, and his name was called the Word of God. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should, what? Smite the nations. Now, look back. You might want to just keep your finger there for a minute. He says in Psalm 2, verse 5, then shall he speak unto them in his wrath. Out of his mouth goeth a sharp two-edged sword. What's he doing? Speaking to them in his wrath. You see it? Prior to that, listen, the heathen are going to rage. They're going to imagine a vain thing. They're saying, let us break their bands asunder. I don't believe they're talking about Israel here. I think they're talking about God. They don't want to follow God. They don't want nothing to do with the God of the Bible. They want their liberal, progressive agenda. We want to marry who we want to marry. Who cares whether it's the same sex or not? Listen, if it gets any worse, listen, they're going to be wanting to marry animals. And people will think it's natural. They're just a step away from it. Hey, if you think a rooster and a rooster can make a hen, there's something wrong with you anyway. Or a hen and a hen can make a rooster. It doesn't happen. You say, well, they're having kids. Yeah, what are they doing? They're going to a rooster to get the stuff to make the... others out of. Christ, in verse 6, defeats them. Where the Bible says, "Yet have I set my king upon my holy hill of Zion." Hey, when the king is there, they're defeated, amen? They're not going to get the victory. They're not going to like what is going to happen. They will be defeated. In verse 11 and 12, he gives a warning. Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling. Hey, it's a fearful thing to stand before an almighty God. I don't care if you're saved or not. Praise God. Listen, he's not your buddy.
Amen.
You're not going to run up to him and, hey, high five, Jesus. My pal. You look throughout the Bible. When people come before God, they hit their face.
Amen.
But yet this world, they're trying to bring God down and make Him just like them and be their buddy and pal. And listen, that He can do, or He will do everything that you do like you're some perfect specimen. Not. Quit trying to bring God down to your level, and how about you step it up to His? God is not a God that can be brought down to you. His righteousness is far above ours. His holiness is way above ours. But the world, instead of trying to get right with God and do what's right, we want to bring Him down to our level. That's why God put the cherubims at the gate of the Garden of Eden. As a reminder, you're not good enough to be here. You come, you'll die. Because there He gave them a flaming sword. In the tabernacle, they had a warning. If they wasn't the one coming with blood and they wasn't right with God, listen, they died on the spot. You think of the young man that was riding on that cart with David. Man, one thing, they wasn't even supposed to have the ark on the cart. They were supposed to be carrying it and supposed to be Levites. And there's a soldier, a poor soldier, following his king, reached back and touched the ark, thought he was doing a good thing and died. Listen, it's a serious matter to try to do God's stuff God's or your way instead of His way. Ask Ananias and Sapphira. They'll tell you. Listen, we need to be the best children of God you can be, and I can be.
Amen.
And I'll tell you this, each one of us can always do better.
Amen.
There's not a one of us that couldn't. He gives that warning. Listen, I like what he says. In verse 12 of Psalm 2, he says, "Kiss the Son, lest He be angry." You better be careful in how you approach Him, in other words. But the world, they treat God like He's you and me. He's worthy of way more than that. The reason I went back to this, I want you to understand, right from the beginning of Psalms, He gives warnings. Now back in Psalm 83, Psalm 83 is really the centerpiece of what is going to be happening as far as the Psalms go. We know from this psalm that God is physically here on the earth. It says, "Keep not silent, O God, hold not thy peace, and be not still." He's here. Psalm 82 and verse 8, the Bible says, "Arise, O God, judge the earth, for thou shalt inherit all nations." Do you understand? I want you to think about this here for a second. When Jesus was here, where was his entire ministry? In Israel. You don't see him making trips to Libya. You don't see him making trips to Persia or Babylon. Galilee, Jerusalem, Samaria, because it lies in between. Capernaum, that's his ministry area. But here the Bible says in Psalm 82 and verse 8, that "for thou shalt inherit all nations." All nations at that time is going to know exactly who God is. Listen, Rome might have heard a little stories about him. France and Spain, who knows? Over in those areas. Listen, you can check the historians. They knew about those areas. They knew about England and some of them other areas in that time period. But I don't know if they heard anything about what Jesus was doing in Israel at that time. But in this, they're going to know. Why? Because it's not the same thing. This is not talking about the time of Christ when he came, was born, lived, and died. This is talking about still a future event for us. He will rule all nations. Psalm 80 and verse 14, "Return, we beseech thee, O God of hosts. Look down from heaven and behold, and visit this vine." Notice they use the word return. Hey, the first time he came, you couldn't say return, because it was the first time he physically came to this earth. But here the psalmist says, "Return, we beseech thee." Listen, what should Christians be praying? Return, O Lord. Come quickly, like John says at the end of the book of Revelation. Please come quickly. Return. That ought to be the cry today. Look down from heaven. Behold, and visit this vine. Now, of course, these are Jews speaking, and he's saying, return, come back again and visit this vine. Visit your children, Israel. And that's what he's coming to do. He's coming to establish Israel forever as his children. They've never been established completely as his children. There's always been division. There's always been that sect that was out and doing their own thing. You say, well, what about the time of Solomon? Solomon was the real downfall. But I believe there was still idol worship in David's time. Because if there wasn't, why did we have so much problems with it after David? It was still suppressed. Listen, they never fully eradicated it from the time they left Egypt. It was still, if you could say, kept in the closet. Why do I say that? Because we have a bad habit when God deals with us about stuff of not getting rid of it and putting it in the closet and later pulling it back out. I think that's why Larry Brown says, listen, if God dealt with you about it, burn it.
Amen.
You burn it, there's no way you can pull it back out. It's totally gone, useless. Dust. This event here in Psalm 83 is revenge for the temple being destroyed and defiled. Look with me in Psalm 79. Asaph, again, the author of 83, says, O God, the heathen are come into thine inheritance. Thy holy temple have they defiled. They have laid Jerusalem on heaps. It was destroyed. The Antichrist has came in and ruined the temple worship. We see it talked about both in Daniel and the book of Revelation by the Apostle John. We hear about him coming back in 2 Thessalonians 2. He's coming in to defile everything that God has established. He's going to try to set up his kingdom and rule the world. And he's going to do that for a short time. Then God's going to put him in his place. Notice also in this passage, God's enemies are listed. Again, in Psalm 83, Edom, verse 6, Edom, Ishmaelites, Moab, Hagarines, the descendants of Hagar, maybe she had other children that later, after she left Abraham and everything went in a different direction. Gebel, Ammon, Amalek, Philistines, Tyre, Asher. The Bible says all these have counseled together. You know what they have in common? They're all Muslim nations today. They have that in common. In Psalm 79 and verse 6, the Bible says, pour out thy wrath upon the heathen that have not known thee, and upon the kingdoms that have not called upon thy name. Hey, guess what? All these people that are going around saying, well, we're just all serving the same God. Wrong. There's even people that call themselves Christians that are not serving the God of the Bible.
Amen.
Listen, it makes me sick how people can say, hey, it's okay to be a sodomite and call themselves Christians. It's okay to put them in a church leadership position and call themselves Christians when God has turned them over to a reprobate mind, according to Romans 1. According to, I believe it's Deuteronomy, he says it's an abomination. And yet the religious folk are wanting to take and put them in places of leadership and say it's fine. Listen, they don't serve the God of the Bible. I'm sorry. And those that totally reject God or Jesus, the false witnesses in them, they're not serving the God of the Bible. Because the Bible says that he would send his son born of a virgin. And they would call his name Emmanuel, meaning God with us. They don't believe he was God. They think he's Satan's brother. Listen. They're not serving the same God. They're not following the same Bible. They're blinded. The Bible says that they have not known thee. There's a lot of people that claim to know him that have no knowledge of him. You say you sound pretty dogmatic about it. That's because in Matthew, and it's either Mark or Luke, it tells you the same thing. There'll be those that come unto him and say, Lord, Lord, call him Master. And he says, depart from me, you worker of iniquity. I never knew you. Kind of sounds like what it says in Psalm 79, verse 6. They have not known thee. They have not called upon thy name. They called on somebody else's name. But it wasn't the God of the Bible. I know it kind of sounds harsh, but that's what the Bible says. Listen, I can preach the Bible. You can believe whatever you want, but if you believe something opposite of what the Bible says, you're probably in trouble. I don't think we've looked at a passage that's really not easily understood. How do you mess up the fact that he says they've not known him? How do you mess up on the fact and what I said about Matthew 7, 21 through 23, where they come and call on him Lord, and he said, depart from me, you worker of iniquity, I never knew you. What part of never do you not understand? What part of new do you not understand? It's going to happen. You see, I want you to, and I've waited to this point, I want you to notice something back in Psalm 83 and verse 6. The enemies who hated God are religious people. Notice, he says, the tabernacles, right, of Edom. That tabernacle goes to all the list of all the people that are on this list. The religious people of these countries. It's the religious folk that's going against God. And by the way, he does call them heathens. We're not worshiping the same God. Don't get that confused. The tabernacles of Eden. And by the way, these are the same nations that we've looked at through the prophets of Joel and Isaiah and all of them. These are the same places we had the map down. We was looking at all of them. You got copies of the map. It's the same places. Maybe listing it on a broader scale as the nation rather than cities. But it's the same places. Psalm 81, verses 8 through 13. The Bible says, hear, O my people, I will testify unto thee. O Israel, if thou wilt hearken unto me, there shall no strange God be in thee, neither shalt thou worship any strange God. There is so many things out there that it's scary. Do you know, many people have gods in their houses and they do not realize it. They're blinded to the fact. The Bible says that we're to make no graven images, right? Do you understand when people bow down before any graven image, that's idol worship? I don't care if they say they're praying to someone else. The fact that they had to go and bow down before that says it all. Listen, some people might look at me and say, well, Pastor, you got eagles all over your office. Yeah, I've got eagles in my office. But I'm not bowing down before them. I don't go into my office and get down on my knees before an eagle and start praying. Now, listen, I'll be honest with you. I might be wrong for having that. I may be. I mean, I'm not bowing down before them, but that is an image, right? But I'm talking about people that will have crucifixes in their bedroom, and they'll go down and they'll bow down and pray before that crucifix. I don't care if you think it's Jesus. The Bible says we're not to have an image of anything in heaven and in earth and beneath the earth, talking about in the water. That means we're not to make an image and call it God. We're not to make an image and call it Jesus.
Amen.
Because you have no clue what He looks like. We're not to do it. But yet, we see this in the world we live in. Neither shalt thou worship any strange god. I am the Lord thy God, which brought thee out of the land of Egypt. Open thy mouth wide, and I will fill it. But my people would not hearken to my voice, and Israel would none of me. Listen, there's a lot of people in this world that will not hearken to the voice of God when God says, don't bow before images. They have none of me. His word clearly says it. What he says. So I gave them up unto their own hearts. Lust. Their heart's lust is to have these things. And I believe, now I understand he's talking about Israel here. Can I get an amen on that? But listen, I think this, if he did that to Israel, look at me and tell me that he would not do it today to all these religious folks that are doing this. He didn't do it right off, but there was a point where God said, okay, your lust got you to do that, to go out and purchase that, to put it there, to bow before it, to pray to it. God said, okay, he told the children of Israel, if that's what you want to do, my hand's off, I'm gone. Listen, there will be a time in each person's life where God does that to them. And no matter what you say to them, they're going to continue to do it. I wonder if God has said, okay, this is what you want, this is what you got. That's a scary thought, isn't it? It sure is. But if God doesn't do it to these people that do it today, listen, I believe he owes Israel an apology. Because there was people in the day that God did this to Israel that hadn't done it for centuries. Maybe they just got into it. But their heritage had done it for centuries. And in their day, it was in their day where God said, enough is enough. I'm done with it. notice what God says there in verse 13 of Psalm 81. Oh, that my people had hearkened unto me. Listen, don't think that God does that happily. In this verse, we see that it grieves his heart. He says, oh, that my people had hearkened unto me, and Israel had walked in my ways. You know, I think God says that today. Oh, if these people would just listen to my word, if they would have just read my word, if they would have listened to that old loudmouth preacher a little bit and walked in my ways, not in the lust of their flesh, the lust of their hearts, but walked in my ways. It doesn't please God for anyone to go to hell. Don't think that. But God is still... Listen, when you have to correct your children, does it break your heart? It should. God's the same way. But he can't be a good parent unless he does chasten them. Because he says, what father loveth his child and chasteneth not? See, this world's philosophy is, hey, don't punish them for anything. That's the reason we got the wreck we got in the world today. Dr. Spock come along, I guess, in the 80s, and things have been going way south a whole lot faster ever since. They walked, the children of Israel walked away from God during the books of Kings and Chronicles. Verse 14, Psalm 81 says, I should soon have subdued their enemies and turned my hand against their adversaries. God says, listen, if they would have just listened to me and followed me, I would have defeated their enemies. Turned his hand against their adversaries. I wonder how much of the battles and struggles we go through in this life, God would look at us and say, listen, if you'd have just walked after me, if you'd have done those things, and I can't name what God's dealt with you about over the past year or whatever, that you didn't deal with, that you refused to deal with. And God would look at you in time of judgment and said, I would have did so much more for you if you would have followed me. Wouldn't that be sad? Remember, he's going to be wiping away tears for something. But he says it right here about Israel. The haters of the Lord should have submitted themselves unto him, but their time should have endured forever. He should have fed them also with the finest of the wheat, and with honey out of the rock should I have satisfied thee. You know, these are the enemies of God he's talking about. They didn't follow him. They rejected him. They went away. You know, God says to his enemies, even today, you missed out. You could have had so much. You could have had so much blessing and peace in your life, but you missed out. You could have lived forever, but you missed out. Why? Because they rejected him and rejected his word. Go back to Psalm 83. Verse 3. They have taken crafty counsel against thy people and consulted against thy hidden ones. They have said, come, let us cut them off from being a nation, that the name of Israel may no more be, or no more in, may be no more in remembrance. These people are the coalition of Psalm 83. And you know there's countries, those countries right now, Persia's the most outspoken one of them, Babylon, it would be the area in Persia that says they want to wipe Israel off the map. Be remembered no more. The heart of the problem is people's rejection of the Lord Jesus Christ today. You think about that. Those people that are doing it today, those are the people that had Daniel the prophet. That's the area where the Magi come from to see Christ. The Magi was the religious wise men of that area. And look where they're at now. Why? Because somewhere along the line, somebody rejected Christ. You don't think those Magi didn't go back to their own country and talk about the king that they had saw? Somewhere between that time and now, people started rejecting Christ and started following their own way. And they are in the place they are now. Psalm 118. I'll start in verse 1. Listen to it. Oh, give thanks, O Lord, for He is good, because His mercy endureth forever. Let Israel now say that His mercy endureth forever. Let the house of Aaron now say that His mercy endureth forever. Let them now that fear the Lord say that His mercy endureth forever. I called upon the Lord in distress. The Lord answered me and set me in a large place. The Lord is on my side, I will not fear. What can man do unto me? The Lord taketh my part with them that help me. Therefore shall I see my desire upon them that hate me. It is better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in man. It is better to trust in the Lord to put confidence in princes. Hey, don't put your confidence in Ottawa. All nations compassed me about, but in the name of the Lord will I destroy them. All nations compassed them about. A reference to all the nations that are going to be coming against him. And he destroys them. That hasn't happened yet. If you haven't figured that out, it hasn't happened yet. But it is going to happen. You see, when you look, I want you to think about this. When you look at Psalm 22, you see the first coming of Christ. Then when you look at Psalm 24, you see the second coming of Christ. Because he says in verse 8, who is this King of glory, the Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle? Lift up your heads, O ye gates, even lift them up, ye everlasting doors. The King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory, the Lord of hosts? He is the King of glory. See, you have 22, the first coming. You have 24, the second coming. And sandwiched in between them is the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Comfort in between the first coming and the second coming. You see, the Psalms talks a lot about the coming of the Lord. It even names nations that are going to be involved. It gives warning. So many times in the Bible, we have seen that this warning is given. People are named. Countries are named that are going to be involved. We look at the world we're in today, and we see everything unfolding and literally just about to happen. Are you ready for His coming? First, are you saved? Listen, have you got it settled? Can you, if God was to stand before you today and say, "Why should I let you in heaven?" Would your answer be backed by Scripture? In other words, would it line up with Scripture? I'm not asking you if you could give Him Scripture. There's going to be a lot of people who can give Him Scripture in that day, but they're going to die and go to hell. But with your answer, would that line up with what the Bible teaches about salvation? Only you can answer that. But if you are saved, are you ready to meet your Savior? Listen, I believe it is coming soon. I look at things that are going on in the world and seeing it happen in a greater way. I'll be honest with you, it scares me, but I see the fall of these two countries coming real soon. I think it is. Are you ready? I don't mean do you have everything stocked up and ready for it. I'm talking spiritually. Would you stand strong in the face of that? There's going to be persecution come. Would you stand strong in the persecution? Or would you deny Him? Listen, that is a slippery slope. I know Peter denied Him. I have no doubt He's in heaven. But you better be careful, because the Bible still says, if you deny Me before man, I'll deny you before the Father. That's not very good. Are you ready for His coming? Let's pray.